Can you say that? Remember, it is family. Most of our interactions are family and close friends. I'm not talking, it's not the strangers on the street, church. Do they really bother you? No. You don't know them. So I just say, if it was that way here, it's got to be that way for us too, I think. I just don't think, I think God's a simple guy when it comes to that stuff. They return at evening. They make a noise like a dog and they go round about the city. Behold, they belch out with their mouth. Swords are in their lips. For who say they doth hear? He's asking a question. Who can hear this? Well, no one can hear it because he wasn't speaking it. He was just thinking it. That's what I'm saying. This is all inside of him. And what's he belching out? I think now he's insulting him. That idiot. That stupid king. He's a chicken. Couldn't take down Goliath. Can't keep his family. His men don't want to serve him. He had to go into battle by himself. Nobody cares about this guy. He's a knucklehead. I think he's insulting Saul. That's what he's belching out. And this dog, it's just the unclean thoughts. When the Bible talks about the dog, it's unclean. It's unclean. And can you satisfy a dog? Not really. Not really. They'll lick you 1 minute, but they'll bite you the next. He's just belching out these insults. But they're all inside of him. But he knows they're wrong. He's like, Lord, it's his evening hour. It's his night hour. It's in this time of darkness. David's knowing. He knows that the light of truth isn't being. Lord, shine some light on this. Come save me. Come free me from these things. No? Anybody ever have turmoil upstairs? You never want to be freed from it? You just want to go around with the turmoil on your head? You just walk around. Meantime, there's a tornado going around in your head. That's the worst feeling. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I think that's what's going on with David here. But thou, O Lord, shalt laugh at them. Thou shalt have all the heathen in derision. I mean, David knows, that's why he's going to God. He knows the Lord can turn this on a dime. The Lord can fill him with grace and joy and mercy on a dime and get rid of it all. And the Lord just laughs at them. He doesn't laugh at people. He doesn't laugh at people. What's he laughing at? The enemy, the carnal mind, the thoughts, because it means nothing to God. God can turn it on a dime at any time he wants to. So he wasn't talking about people here. Because of his strength will I wait upon thee, for God is my defense. What's his strength? It's truth. Those feelings and those thoughts that David were having, was that truth? No, they were lies. They were lies because, again, it was the external. It was what he was seeing. It was what he was hearing. It wasn't the Christ that was inside of him. It's a lie. What's God's strength? God's strength is always truth. That's why I believe his truth does matter, right? Jesus said that. It's the way to eternal life, the way, the truth. You do need truth to live eternal life. Without it, sometimes I live a lie. I live a lie and I don't even know it. Maybe I live this life of entitlement. And believe me, church, I lived a life of entitlement for a lot of years, man. After all, I'm in church. I'm entitled. And then you got one morning, you got to wake up and say, Lord, deliver me from that train wreck. What was I thinking? Only because I just didn't understand. I was misunderstood. I didn't know the nature and the character of God. Not that I haven't fully comprehended now, but I know more. I have a better understanding. I continue to awake with his likeness. Amen. We continue to awake with his likeness. I know if I awake with it, then you have to awake with it because we are a body. We are the body of Christ. Amen. We are the body of Christ. Amen. The God of my mercy shall prevent me. Prevent him what? From being a nutcase and doing something stupid. That's what he's preventing him. God's never prevented you. He's prevented me many a times, church. Many a time where I'm sure those boys that bugged my daughter, I could have very easily been locked up. Mr. Porzio, you really can't hit that man with a bat. We frown upon that. Oh, really? I didn't know. He's preventing him. Preventing David from saying or doing something silly. Man, isn't that a prayer we need to pray a little more? I do. Lord, prevent me. for I don't know what I'm going to say next. God shall let me see my desire upon my enemies. What's that mean? He's going to defeat him. And if he's going to defeat him, and here's why it matters, church. Here's why it matters. Because if he's going to, my desire is what? Well, it's peace. It's not turmoil. I don't want turmoil in my head. You don't want turmoil in your head. What do you want? Peace. Joy. The kingdom. Those righteousness, peace, and joy. It is the kingdom of God. That life. I want that life. I don't want this turmoil in my head. I want my enemies to be defeated. I want peace. My desire is peace. Guess what God's desire for your life is? It's peace, man. See now our desire. See how he does that? See how he takes my desire and it becomes, oh, that's just like you, God. I'm awakened with your likeness. Yeah, you want peace. That's what I want. Now we both want the same thing. Can two walk together except they agree? Now we can walk together because we both want peace. David could walk with God. Why? Because he wanted peace. He loved Saul. I believe he wanted a relationship with Saul. I believe he wanted to be able to sit at the dinner table with Saul and enjoy family. I believe that was the heart of David. It had to be the heart of David. And I think he continued to pursue it no matter what. He continued to pursue it. Church, you should always pursue it. That is the likeness of God. When does he give up? God never gives up, man. Never. It's not in his nature. It's not in his character. God can never give up. It's impossible. Lo, I am with you always. Translation, I can never give up on you. Which means the same for you. Because you awake with his likeness, you can never give up on anybody. Even if it's your Saul, do not give up on them. Pursue peace. Pursue restoration. Pursue a relationship. Pursue it, pursue it, pursue it. When? As long as you got breath in your lungs, pursue it. Pursue it. Amen? Amen. Verse 13. Consume them in wrath. Consume them that they may not be. And let them know that God ruleth in Jacob unto the ends of the earth. He's got the whole earth, church. I don't know how he does it. And what does he consume in the wrath? That word, it's orge. It means to breathe upon, to blow upon. It's just the breath of God, man. It's the same thing when he breathed life into Adam. It was the same thing when the wind came into the mighty wind in the upper room. It's the breath of God. What else is going to change my life? The breath of God. And he just gets rid of that. It's just the mercy and the love of God that he will do that all the way till the ends of the earth. Until I have no more earth and all I have is heaven. All you have is heaven. Amen? Amen? And at the evening, let them return and let them make noise like a dog and go round about the city. Let them wander up and down for meat. And grudge if they be not satisfied. Again, he's going back to the dogs. The dogs are inside of him. All of these are dogs, okay? The enemy, it's the dog. The dog is the enemy, church. he's not talking about Saul. It's the dog, it's inside of us. Again, it's just this unclean thought, this unclean nature, this unclean characteristic. And I believe it's resentment, church. I believe it's resentment. I think it's Proverbs says that the dog that returns to its vomit, so the fool his folly. Why does a dog return? It's just resentment. Is there anything in resentment? You having resentment, is there any value in having resentment, being resentful? Maybe he was resentful of Saul for being king at all. Maybe he was resentful because he married into this crazy family. I don't know, but I believe it's just a picture of that. And he wanders what? Up and down. It's just this chaotic state. One time I'm up, next minute I'm down. Like, we can't even make a decision. Yes, he's my father-in-law. I'm going to choke the life out of him. We would never do that with anybody in our lives, right? Why? Because we expect them to do and say certain things, and when they don't, we resent them for it. Resentment has no place in the kingdom of God. Because God doesn't hold any resentment of you or anybody else. And the people in your life, including Saul, aren't there just to mess up your life. But that's why we have resentment, because you have messed up my life. Congratulations, the devil has the victory, not God. Now, he doesn't have to have the victory, but if we would just, again, look to Christ and trust God and believe in God. But I think that's what the dog is. Isn't that what, didn't Jezebel get eaten by dogs? Amen. It's just a picture to show you. Why did Jezebel? Listen, she was the most entitled, selfish, resentful person on the face of the earth. She was the queen of Israel. She was married to King Ahab. Family. Yeah, the dogs came and ate her. And that's what happens when you let resentment sit in your life. It's going to consume you. It's going to consume your life, man. It's going to consume your life. And remember, remember Naboth's vineyard? Ahab wanted it. Nah, I'd like to keep it. It's just a small little vineyard. I'm very happy. I believe God's given it to me, and I want to keep it. Oh, okay. And what'd she do? She got two guys. She called a high holy day, praised Naboth, and said, I want you to go, and then I want you to lie and tell him, say that he cursed the king and he cursed God. And those two witnesses lied. And what'd they do? Oh, they stoned him. They killed him. And then she got the vineyard. Well, isn't that nice? Why? Because she's selfish. Even resentment itself is a form of selfishness, church. It is. It's self-indulgence. It's all of that. I mean, it's all of that. That's why he says they look for meat, but they're never satisfied. Dogs will eat and eat and eat, right? They won't stop. They'll keep eating. You put food in, they're going to keep eating. They'll explode, but they're going to keep on eating. That meat, it's just a picture to show you. It's just that self-indulgence. Because remember, Christ, meat can be good or it can be bad. Everything, I don't care what it is, it could be good, it could be bad. Is that like every one thing is this? You got to look at the context and what he's saying here and what's the message and what's he talking about. Because Jesus Christ said, I have meat you know not of. What was his meat? Sacrifice. Amen. It's the opposite of resentment. See, resentment says I didn't get enough. Sacrifice says, I know I don't care. I haven't given enough. That's the meat you know not of. That's the meat you know not of. And I think it's also Romans that says that. He says, mark them which cause division and strife. He says, they serve not Christ. They serve their own belly. And they have good words and fair speeches, but they deceive the heart of the simple. Why? Because they cause division. Maybe because they're entitled. Maybe because they think you don't deserve it. Or maybe they deserve more. You see what I'm saying? I think Romans also says, or Corinthians also says that meat's for the belly, belly for the meats. God will destroy it and them both. So they both die. God gets rid of them both anyway. Because I can't get rid of it. You can't get rid of it. Over time, he gets rid of it, and then our desires become the same as his desires, which is righteousness. It is peace. It is joy. And it's not to live this life of resentment. And I think that's the picture that he's showing you here. And if you do, you will never be satisfied. He says it right here. You can never, if you have resentment, you can never be satisfied. You will live an unfulfilled life. Or you can say, Lord, help me, deliver me, and show me, and teach me what I need to. Wasn't that Jonah? Hey, I need you to save these people. They're wicked. I don't want to save them. They stink. I don't want to go to Nineveh. He went and saved them. What happened? Oh, the fish vomited Jonah up on the shore. Don't you love the irony? Why? Because he was resentful. Tweet, you're going to go do it anyway. Hey, he is a funny God. It was resentment. He said, Jonah, shouldn't I care about these people? Who shouldn't God care about? Yeah, but they're a heathen nation. No, they're my people. They're my people. But what? Jonah said, no, those ain't Israelites, man. They ain't part of the real fam. No one would ever do that. They ain't part of the real fam. They're just in-laws. Perish the thought. Verse 16. But I will sing of thy power. Yea, I will sing aloud of thy mercy in the morning. For thou hast been my defense and refuge in the day of my trouble. When's he singing? In the day of his trouble, he's singing. David's singing. He was praying. He went through a couple of prayers. Now he shifted gears. Okay, time to start singing. Why? Well, because I won't let them have the victory. I am going to take the victory. How? By singing. Church, it's hard to be resentful. It's hard to be, you know, entitled. It's hard to do all those things if you're singing about the love of God. You can't do both. So David's got this change of heart, and now he's singing. Unto thee, O my strength, will I sing, for my God is my defense, the God of my mercy. Church, sometimes I may not feel like singing. You know what I do? Yeah, I sing anyway. Because you ain't going to know if there's a tornado in my head or not. And I don't want to know if there's one in yours. But you can pray and ask God to help you from that. And you can pray that he opens up your eyes and that you don't see the people in your life as enemies. And that you give up on them. Instead, you realize that the only way you're going to be satisfied is until you awake with his likeness. And that is the truth. It's scripture. I mean, it is the Psalm 17. Read it. The only way anyone, I don't care who you are or where you're from, the only way is if we become more like God and live like Christ. And when we do, I believe we are satisfied. We will find, I believe, the true joy. Amen. Ask the worship team if they'll come. I thank God for what he continues to show us, and I pray that he continues to deliver and save us every day, church. And that we will live this life. We will live by his kingdom, by righteousness, by peace, and by joy. Amen. Why don't you stand while we close out?